So in the first segment, we spoke about herbs, how to use them, how to select them, how to choose them, how to store them. And now moving on, what we're going to talk about is the second part of this particular session, where we'll be talking about wines, okay? So if we talk about wines, what comes to our mind when we hear the word wine? At least for me, alcohol. So if somebody asks, what is a wine? So we can say wine is an alcoholic beverage, which is the fermented juice of freshly harvested grapes. And the two most popular and the common variety of the grape that we can talk about here is the white and the black grapes. Moving on, we have documented evidence of wines being used in India itself around 3,500 years ago. And obviously with time, the art of winemaking got refined. These days, just like in the herb context, we spoke about a herbalist, but in the wine context, we have some people called, or a term called sommelier, who are the wine experts present in most of the Michelin star restaurants and fine dining outlets, who have educated the palate to a whole new level, and they are the ones who recommend the right wine to be taken with the food that the guest is ordering. So they're known as sommeliers. Now let's just talk about the classification of wine so that we can have a basic understanding of using them in cooking. Okay, so if we talk about wine, wine can be classified based on its color, taste, and content. So if you're talking about the color, we have white wine, red wine, rosé, and blush. So if you're talking about a rosé wine, what we're looking forward to is pink wine. Okay, and a blush is a degree lighter than rosé. Moving on, if you're talking about taste, we have dry, sweet, and medium. And when we talk about dry, what we mean here is the all the sugar present in that particular wine has been converted into alcohol. And when we talk about sweet wines, they are those wines where the sugar content is still very much intact in that particular wine. And if you talk about the taste of a medium wine, it is somewhere between the dry and the sweet wine. On the basis of content, we have still wines, which are actually allowed to ferment naturally without adding any kind of additives. And we allow the carbon dioxide of the particular wine to escape naturally. And usually it has an alcoholic percentage ranging from 10 to 14%. Cabernet Sauvignon is a very good example for a still wine. Then we have sparkling, and if we're talking about sparkling wines, these are wines which are allowed to ferment, but the carbon dioxide is not allowed to escape. But on the other hand, we impregnate or we add in a bit more of carbon dioxide to this particular wine, because of which it generates this effervescence and which gives a sparkle to this particular wine. And sparkling wine usually has an alcoholic content ranging from 10 to 13%. And one of our most favorite or the popular sparkling wine that we can talk about is the Champagne, from the Champagne region of France, obviously. And moving on, we have this next category, that is depending upon the content. We have the fortified wines, which are wines where the alcoholic strength has been fortified or strengthened by adding a bit of brandy to it. And fortified wines has an alcoholic percentage ranging between 16 to 22%. A very good example would be of our port, sherry, madeira, marsala, etc. Then we have aromatized wines, where the wines are actually flavored with different types of aromatic herbs, barks, spices. The alcoholic percentage ranges between 14 and 20%. And a vermouth is a very good example for an aromatized wine. And finally, we have the tonic wine, which are basically wines which are believed to have health improvers added to it that gives a bit more of energy and strength and stamina to people who will be consuming them.
So after classifying wines, now let's go ahead and talk about the uses of wine in cooking. So let's talk about, or rather understand, why is wine such a favorite for all the chefs to use in the kitchen? Okay? Why do we actually have most of the chefs using wines in cooking? So what does this particular wine consist of? So what are those? Wine is very flavorful, so it has flavor. It has this mild sweetness, acidity, moisture, which is very important. And finally, we have we have all that's present in wine. Now at this point of time, I would like to just talk about this alcohol part, because whenever we are talking about using wine in cooking, we always simmer that particular sauce where the wine has been used, because the idea here is to burn off the alcohol. Okay? So understanding, or the idea is to burn off the alcohol and let the flavor profile of that particular wine to be left behind, which will actually accentuate and flavor the particular dish where we are using this particular wine. Now yes, wines can be used for making different types of marinades. We talk about our white marination liquor, red marination liquor, name it, different types of marinade use wine in some form or the other. For making our delicious sauces in the kitchen, for example, you take a frying pan and then you take some butter and olive oil and then you saute the onions, garlic, leek and celery. So at a point of time, you find that the ingredients will start to caramelize, okay? And at that point of time, as a chef, we always need to add some moisture in some form or the other. And this is the point of time where most of our chefs, we add wine. And this process, okay, or this particular method of adding wine to that particular frying pan, when those ingredients have just started caramelizing, it's technically known as deglazing. So obviously, when you add wine, it prevents those ingredients from caramelizing, and on the other hand, adds that those subtle flavors, acidity, sweetness, and obviously moisture. So after deglazing, we'll talk about this concept of flaming. And yes, even as a student, or rather, a young trainee in the hotel, when I walked inside the professional kitchen, the thing that intrigued me was seeing those chefs working in front of those ranges and the roaring sound of those burners or those ranges, and then the flat of the frying pan set on fire or the box set on fire. So yes, definitely wines are also used for flambé, where it is basically a showmanship on the part of the chef. Because when you go inside the restaurant to dine, you're not going there just for food or beverage, you're going there for an experience, right? So these kind of small kind of showmanship adds on to the overall experience for the particular guest. And apart from showmanship, when you flambé a dish, it also adds a very nice, subtle, smoky aroma to the dish that you're preparing. So be it on the teppanyaki grill, or on the wok, or on the frying pan, or the sauce pan, when you very flame it, yes, it adds on a nice aroma to the dish. However, please be very careful if you're starting off with working with wines to flambé dishes, because as you know, alcohol content in wine is pretty high, and the moment you add it, it might catch on fire. So what I suggest is, if you want to add wine in a frying pan that is hot, try to remove the particular frying pan off the flame, and then add a bit of it, and then slowly put it back on the flame. And once it flambés, do not get nervous, or do not panic. If it goes out of control, just remove it off the flame, and try to keep the flame into moderate or low intensity. Next is talking about stocks. Yes, wines are also used to flavor fondue cuisine, for flavoring different types of stock. Here we have Escoffard, which is a very good example where we use wine to flavor it. And apart from stock, there are other different types of liquid that is used in the dish, like a cold bouillon or a poaching liquor, where we normally use different types of herbs and some amount of wine for poaching different types of fish, seafood, or the meat that you are flavoring.
So if you're talking about wines being used as a flavoring agent or an ingredient, yes, definitely it's very commonly used, and I'm sure all of us have come across chefs adding a splash of wine just before taking off that particular food off the flame. And yes, at this point of time, I'll be talking about a different concept of wine here, okay? Because as of now, whatever we discussed was wine is the fermented juice of freshly harvested grapes. But in the Southeast Asian countries, there is a concept of using rice wine, okay, where they ferment the rice grains along with yeast, and the alcoholic wine that they actually get out of that particular fermentation is also used in cooking. For example, the Shaoxing wine, if you talk about the red yeast wine, we have sake, we have mirin, which are also used as flavoring for different types of dishes. So yes, wine, if you're talking about wine, wine is the particular liquid that has a balance of the sweetness, the acidity, the flavors, the moisture, and I don't think there's any other liquid that is as well balanced as the wine that we use in cooking. Now let's talk about selecting wines for cooking. Okay, so how to go and select wines that needs to be used for cooking. Now, what we can say is, cook with wines you drink. Okay, so if you're planning to buy a bottle of wine, we can obviously use a bit of the particular wine to marinate that particular ingredient. But if you're working in a hotel, obviously, when you work with T-bone steaks or porterhouse or Kobe beef or a John Doe or a tuna or a Norwegian salmon, so we don't want to use any kind of cheap ingredients to cook with those protein. In the same manner, we don't want to also use cheap wines for cooking. Okay, so here I don't mean by opening up a Chateau Latour for marinating your lamb chops, but in the Indian context, a wine that is anywhere between 1,000 to 1,200 rupees is a good option for using it for cooking in the kitchen. Next thing, refrain from using very old wines which has not been stored properly, because what happens is when wines are stored for a long time without proper storage, or rather unused wines, it starts turning sour. Okay, so try not to use wines, or rather residual wines that has been opened and then not stored properly. Now we also come across this particular term called cooking wines, which are also nowadays very popular. But the catch here is that these wines are made with inferior quality grapes, and it has an added salt content in it. So there are many chefs who like using them, and there are many who try to refrain from using them. But I personally suggest, if you have a good bottle of wine that is ranging between 1,000 to 1,200 rupees, why not use them? If you're going ahead and investing so much of money to buy or purchase that fresh lobster, or going ahead and making sure that you get those crab sticks which are very fresh, so rather invest a bit of money in purchasing a good quality wine for cooking. Because at the end of the day, it is not the flavor or the meat or the ingredient that is going to be highlighted. It is the overall package or the dish that is being highlighted. Now, moving on, take note of the flavors found in the wine you will be cooking with. So yes, if you are going and purchasing a wine for cooking, you can very much see the label of the particular wine, and there you get a brief understanding about the kind of flavor or the bouquet that particular wine would be having. A very simple guideline here. Usually, most of the red wines have the flavors of berries, spices, cocoa, and minerals, and the white wines are usually having the flavors of citrus fruits, vanilla, honey, and butter. So if you are cooking with something that is robust, okay, a bit rustic, you can go for the red wine. And if you're working with something delicate and subtle, you can normally go for the white wine. So match the boldness of the food with the wine. And at any point of time, we should make sure that the flavor of the wine doesn't overpower the flavor of the dish. So here we have white wine, use it for white meats. And now if you're talking about white meats, we're talking about those meat that is having a low amount of myoglobin content. And for example, we have different types of fish, seafood, and if you're going for dark meats, if you're cooking with dark meats, try to go for a red wine. And if you're going to use, you're planning to use wines in desserts for making different types of liquid chocolates or different types of other, your tiramisu, we normally go for a sweet wine. Okay, so now going a bit more in detail about the kind of wine to select for the kind of food that you're going to prepare with. Here's a simple guideline to going not very wrong, I would say. Go for delicate wines with delicate flavors, okay? So if you are planning to cook something delicate and subtle like an asparagus risotto, a crisp fruity wine like a Sauvignon Blanc or a Riesling would be a good choice. Now, on the other hand, if you are going to make a hardy mushroom risotto, then an oaky Chardonnay would serve the purpose. If you're planning to go for pastas, then light fruity reds like Pinot Noir would do very well. And if you're working, or rather planning to work with those heavy, deep, meaty flavors, then a deep Merlot or a Cabernet Sauvignon, Cabernet Franc or a Shiraz would do the purpose, or rather serve the purpose. Now, coming to the last part of this particular session, where we talk about pairing of wine with food. Okay, so this is just a simple guideline which will help us to understand and to choose the right wine to order with the right food. So obviously, the first thing is you order the food, and then depending upon the flavor profile of the particular food, you can order for the wine that can go well with that particular dish. So if you're ordering white meats and seafood, we can go for the white wines. If you're ordering red meats, you can go for the red wines. If you're going for the desserts, you can go for the sweet wines. And if you're ordering champagne, then it can be enjoyed any time of the day, or rather throughout the meal, it can be served as an aperitif or any time. But however, after we talk about these four guidelines here, at the end of the day, it is the guest who decides it, okay? So if a guest chooses to go for a white wine with a red meat, he or she is not wrong, okay? You're paying for that particular food. If you like that kind of taste, so be it. So there's no hard and fast rule into what kind of wine should go with what kind of meat. But this is just a brief understanding for people who are just starting off with this particular concept of using wine in food and pairing wine with food. And so I hope I did not bore all of you, and I did not take much of your time as well. And this is the end of this particular session. And just to summarize it, so what are the takeaways from this particular session? Always use fresh herbs, okay? Store them properly. Yes, very important, because you're not going to be just a cook in the near future. Being a chef is about handling the whole restaurant, talking about the budgets, talking about the food costing. So you don't want anything being thrown in the dustbin unless until it is of no use. Dry herbs the right way. So if you have time, if you have resources, go for drying herbs the right way. Refrain from putting those herbs on the baking tray and then putting it under the salamander or putting it inside the oven that has just been switched off. Dry herbs the right way and store them properly. Airtight container, do not refrigerate. Choose the right wine for cooking. And the last point, which I personally feel is the most important point, do not stop experimenting. You'll find that once you start working in a hotel, there will be a point of time in life where you feel that it's very monotonous, okay? You come in every day, you do the same thing over and over again. So the thing that keeps us going, apart from the KOPs that keeps on flowing, coming out from the particular counter, is experimenting. Keep experimenting with different types of food plating. Keep experimenting with different types of relishes that you bake in the kitchen. Experiment with different types of herbs in marinades. Use different types of wines for marination. Keep on experimenting. Try out different new recipes, you know. Check out different YouTube channels. Go for talking to different types of chefs. And if you have already done your training, and I'm sure you have already done it, keep in touch with those chefs, you know. Because each and everybody working in the hotel, they do have some quality inside them, okay? So even if you can take just one quality out of those people whom you have worked with, I think that would serve the purpose. And yes, at the end of the day, do not forget them. Now, a small homework for all of us here. If you have worked in the hotel and you have some contacts in the hotel, so you don't need to literally go to the hotel. So you can just list down 10 dishes from the menu card of a 5-star hotel in your vicinity and describe the herbs and wines used in those dishes. So you can go for the hotel's websites and try to take out the menu cards from those fine dining restaurants, and then just list down 10 dishes and talk about the flavors of the herbs and the wines, and rather the kind of herbs and wines which are being used in those dishes. And these are some of the photographs of the food plating that we did in our practical classes, where we have used the concept of different types of herbal oils, using different types of herbs and different types of flavored vinegar. So here we had used the balsamic vinegar that has been flavored with rosemary. We also use different types of microgreens for plating them. We fluted the mushrooms. We have used parsley oil on the jus that we have here. And yes, a sprig of leek just to garnish this particular plating, along with some balsamic vinegar. Here we have this concept of herb crusted. So we have crusted these grilled vegetables with finely chopped fresh parsley, the English parsley. And we have made a reduction of the pomegranate along with flavoring, or rather flavoring it with a bit of thyme. So we have used these ingredients. These are the regular menus that we have every day. But we try to experiment with the different types of way or the different ways in which the food can be plated. And I urge all of you and encourage all of you to do so as well, as in when you get time. This is our mini island kind of setup that we did with some chicken, grilled chicken, along with some turned vegetables. We have carrots and mushrooms, along with potatoes and some microgreens, and a tulle that is made with refined flour, a bit of water, refined oil, and some edible food color. This is the dish, again the same similar kind of a dish, where we have used the grilled chicken that has been sliced on a bed of chopped English parsley. And we made this mock caviar flavored with the reduction of pomegranate juice with thyme. And we have used the rosti to be wrapped around the Japanese nori sheet. And we have this blanched and lightly tossed vegetables like asparagus, carrots being used as a stuffing in the center. So please do keep experimenting, okay? So see here we have used the fresh oregano and some red spinach and some herbal oil to garnish this particular food plating. And last but not least, thank you so much for giving it such a patient hearing. Oh, I hope I have been able to communicate to all of you in the right, in the best possible manner. I wish you all the best in the near future, and I hope to see you all. And trust me, being a chef is fun. I have been in this profession for the past 13 years, and I hope that God gives me the opportunity to stay in this particular profession for the rest of my life. So I wish you all the best, and thank you for watching. Bye-bye.